Alright, well, it seems like the sore throat keeps hitting me, so if I sound a bit different in this video, you know why. I know even less about prehistoric mammals than I do about dinosaurs, but they've always fascinated me. I've wanted to review some of mine, but I didn't know where to begin. Well, the last time I reviewed an old PNSO figure, the 2019 Mosasaurus, and it reminded me of an even older PNSO model that I have that was also a massive sea animal. In fact, it sort of took over from Mosasaurus as the apex predator of the Tethys Sea. And it was a mammal to boot. And suddenly, my first mammal review was obvious. Basilosaurus, the prehistoric whale. And actually, it's my very first PNSO figure. You see, I first heard of PNSO through three offerings: the Basilosaurus, the Shantongsaurus, and the Huanghe Titan. I guess you could call these vintage PNSOs. As you can see, the box is very different from the elegant white box we've now come to love. And while sauropods are my favorite dinosaur group, it was really the Basilosaurus that got me to pull the trigger. Because while the images look great, I doubted the actual models would really look that good. But Basilosaurus looked too compelling, and since I've never had one, I went ahead. And I'm pleased to say that my leap of faith paid off. This is the 2016 PNSO Basilosaurus. And as you might guess from the suffix "saurus," it was originally thought to be a prehistoric reptile. Indeed, the name means king lizard, which is obviously ironic. A Basilosaurus has been estimated to measure 15 to 20 meters, which is 49 to 66 feet. And at 55 centimeters, or 21 inches long, this model is about 1 to 27th to 1 to 36th scale. You can see the overall shape is very elongated and eel-like. That's quite reminiscent of the Mosasaurus. This convergent evolution suggests that the serpentine body actually confers some advantages to that lifestyle. The way the front limbs are so far away from the hind limb, it always seemed like a creature of fantasy to me. Like a Chinese dragon. The flippers are surprisingly small for the size of the animal. Interestingly, Basilosaurus still retained much of the limb bones of its land-dwelling forebears. Other whales like Dorodon atrox had greatly reduced hind limbs, and Ankylosaurus seems to have lost them completely. The head is still visibly separate, unlike modern whales, and it's small proportionate to the body, even more so than we saw in the Mosasaurus. It almost looks comical, but for these rows of huge teeth, Basilosaurus still had different teeth in different regions, such as the incisors, the canines, and the molars, a primitive condition reflecting its recent land predator origins. You can see that in the skull of Basilosaurus cetoides here. According to Yuan in 2018, Basilosaurus would have the dental formula per half jaw of 3 incisors, 1 canine, 4 premolars, and 2 molars. Now compare that to modern toothed whales with more uniform teeth throughout, as you see here in a drawing of an orca skull by artist Manuel Sosa. Now here, in this model, each is individually sculpted, and while I'm not crazy enough to count and verify the number and type, the overall appearance is close enough to satisfy my plebeian taste. Speaking of teeth, Basilosaurus actually preyed on other whales like Dorodon. For example, Falky in 2012 examined bite marks on Dorodon skulls. Did castings of the impressions? which matched the teeth of Basilosaurus Isis. She also conducted CT scans, digital surface scanning, and 3D reconstruction of a few Dorodon skulls, and then placed them within the mouth of a Basilosaurus, finding good fits between the teeth of Basilosaurus and the puncture marks on the fossils. The jaw articulates, and within, you can see the tongue is clearly separate and a deep red. The only thing I don't like is how the lower jaw projects forward further than the upper, and I don't think that prognathism was a feature of the animal, but if I'm wrong, someone please correct me in the comments below. And down here, you'll see some bumps, which are probably parasitic barnacles, but it could also be the tubercles you'll see on humpback whales. Believe it or not, these are oversized hair follicles about the size of your fist, which might serve as some kind of sensory organ. But these ones are definitely barnacles. Just look at the detail. Even at this small size. These four bumps down here, however, seem too neatly arranged, and I wonder what they are. If anyone knows, again, please comment below. While the PNSO Mosasaurus was surprisingly heavy, this PNSO Basilosaurus is surprisingly light. And that's because it's how PNSO originally constructed their offerings. Hollow vinyl. And that leads to one issue many people have with them. Visible seam lines, which are more obvious than you'll see in current figures. Now, I can normally overlook them, except that here, unfortunately, someone really messed up in the painting process. And the white on the front is very obviously different from that of the body. And you'll see a very obvious disjoint here. But on this side, it's okay. It's really a pity, but after a while, you just don't process it. Besides that, the paint scheme and application is incredible. It's countershaded with grey and cream, with plenty of shades throughout. Now, within the cream are scatterings of mottling, which I love. And within the greys, you can see patterning done very subtly. It looks like subcutaneous pigmentation, always a beautiful look. I love the discontinuity here, giving a pie ball appearance. And it's obvious there were multiple layers of application, especially up here in the head region. Look at all the subtle shades and fades in the skin. It's really hard to believe that this was one of PNSO's earliest works. Just beautiful. The base, interestingly, is done nicer than the one that came with the Mosasaurus that was actually produced after this. Now, this grey base is completely functional, just like that awful base that we saw with the Ceratosaurus figure. And yet, the Basilosaurus, which came before it, actually has some effort put into it, with a look of wet sand and ripples from water movement, so that's a very nice touch. Now let's compare him to the PNSO Mosasaurus again. Although I reckon this to be 1 to 40th scale, if we take PNSO's stated scale, then this is 1 to 35th scale, making it scale very nicely with the Basilosaurus. So they look fantastic next to each other, perhaps symbolizing the passing of the torch of rulership of the tethys from Mosasaurus to Basilosaurus. It's almost ironic to call this vintage PNSO, because if you consider the detail, the accuracy, the paint application, it was already way ahead of many popular manufacturers and portended of great things to come, which, as we have now seen, did come to pass. So that's it for the PNSO Basilosaurus, my very first PNSO, and I believe my very first prehistoric mammal review. And I look forward to sharing more prehistoric mammal reviews with you in the near future. Take care, guys.